Can we put up our hands together as we bring the servant of God?
Yes.
In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Let's continue clapping to Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise.
Yes.
Glorify the Lord, for he is good. Let me share this topic briefly. The topic I'm calling gratitude produces peace and contentment. Gratitude produces peace and contentment. I repeat, gratitude produces peace and contentment. As you give us Philippians chapter number 4, starting from verse 6, I want to give an introduction here, and I tell you, when you see the word gratitude, gratitude means the heart and the attitude of thankfulness. It is the lifestyle of thankfulness. When you have gratitude, means you have the art, you have the heart, the lifestyle of saying thank you. And when you talk of it, it's not just the words of the mouth, but gratitude has to do even with actions. Gratitude has to do even with your emotions. The way you relate with the people, it can be noted whether you have gratitude or not. And I want to say here that when we are living here on earth, many are the issues that we are going to fight with. Issues will be all over. But I want you to know, we have been mandated, we have been given the responsibility to be thankful. That's why when we have been looking at the scriptures, we have seen that in all circumstances, give thanks unto God, for this is his will concerning you in Christ Jesus. So God expects that everywhere, every time, you have gratitude, you have thankfulness. Now, this is what I'm saying produces contentment and peace. When you look at contentment or peace, you'll find these are things that will keep you moving, that will keep you steadfast. When somebody is peaceful, when somebody is contented, you'll discover this person is not upset. Not because the environment is smooth, but because the heart has trained itself to be thankful. These are the people you hear when they start singing in times of trouble. They have a song in their heart that no matter how things are, my God is still on the throne. It doesn't matter what I'm going through, but in him I have peace. These are people who have trained themselves to be thankful unto God. Can I also say, the more you spend in being thankful, the more content and contented your life shall be. It is important to know people who are opposite of this, people who do not become thankful, people who have no gratitude, people who don't want to consider the good that has been done to them. These people on the other end, the other extreme, they are people with a lot of complaints. Remember when they were in the wilderness, the children of Israel, the main reason why they died, the majority died because of ingratitude, being ungrateful. They died, and because once you have no gratitude, what happens is you start complaining. Let's remind ourselves, look at Philippians chapter 4, verse number 6. Today, let me talk about contentment because it's very important in thanksgiving. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your request be made known to God. Look at that. It is the moment Paul is talking about how we present our prayers before God. But he is not leaving behind the word thanksgiving. Let's read again. Be anxious for nothing. In other words, do not be controlled by anxiety. So anxious, so upset, peacelessness. Do not be controlled by that. Even if you have needs, he says, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving. As you pray, combining with thanksgiving, let your request be made known to God. Does that mean there are some people's prayers and requests that are not known to heaven because they fail to be thankful? I want to say this to the church and to the entire body of Christ. It is God calling us to be thankful. The moment we present our request, our prayers to God with thanksgiving, that means God is waiting for, let me talk of two baskets. There is the basket of thanksgiving and the basket of our troubles and our prayers and requests. They must go together. If you are thankless, if you are in gratitude, you don't give praise, you don't thank God, how do you expect him only to be looking at your trouble? Can I tell you, the two baskets I'm saying reaching God, the one of thanksgiving is what he is eating. The one for your trouble is the work he is doing for you. If you give somebody only work to do and you are not paying him, you are not appreciating him, what are you saying in the real sense? Let me tell you, with prayer and supplication, in everything, with thanksgiving, let your request be made known unto God. Look at the other verse, something unique. You find verse 7. And the peace of God, imagine, when you do that with thankfulness, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your heart and mind through Christ Jesus. How many love peace? You like to have peace. Amen. I have a granddaughter, and her main reason of coming to church is to meet a boy called Peace. Anytime you say she's not coming to church, the question is, I'm not going to see Peace. I've been asking the father of this boy, well, you know, with that name, you see, it's like even the environment where the boy is, children can sense peace. May God bless that boy to continue that way. But my granddaughter says, I'm going to church, I must see peace. I've never heard her talking of John or any other boy or Dave, and there are many others, but her heart, as small as she is, her name that comes is peace. We all love peace. We like to have the environment of peace. But look at this. After you are thankful, what happens is peace of God, which cannot be compared. It measures to no other. It is the greatest. It cannot be understood. Will guard your heart. Guard your heart and mind through Christ Jesus. The guarding of the heart, and especially today, so many issues are rising and they are making people's hearts to move at a supersonic speed. You are alone and asleep, but you are sleepless in the bed, and it's like you are running because of the demands, because of the issues that are calling you. There are many problems you are called upon to solve. There are people who are hunting you. There are people who are following you here and there. Projects are getting incomplete and there are deadlines. People are moving. But I thank God, because when we learn to be thankful, even when things are demanding, our hearts shall be guarded. We shall be guarded, both the heart and our mind, through Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. I declare prophetically, may your heart and your mind be guarded. May the peace of God that surpasses all understanding, even as we close the year 2020, may that be your portion, that your heart will be guarded. Hallelujah. Do you remember the scenario when this man Job, when what happened? You remember what Satan had said? Please, you know, it's like, allow me. Yes, you see, if we destroy whatever Job has, he will not thank you again. But I thank God for his heart was content. Look at what God told Satan. You go and touch everything, but do not touch his heart. The heart must be guarded. Because Proverbs 4:23 is that above all else, guard your heart, for that is the wellspring of life. Now, when you see this, you see the importance of our heart and our minds guarded. I want to declare under this ministry, under the grace of God, nobody will go crazy. Nobody will go mad. Nobody will be depressed. We say no. We declare that our hearts and our minds are guarded. Even if you don't say amen, I bless you with that. You are blessed. You will not run. And let me declare, even with blood pressure, I declare in the name of Jesus, we are not going to run. We are going to be content. We are going to be peaceful through Jesus Christ. Give us verse 8. Verse 8, the Bible says, finally, brethren, are we there, did it? Is that where we are? Yes. Brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there is any virtue, and if there is anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. Meditate on these things. Now let me show you. When we talk of contentment, this is where we are. The moment you talk of contentment, it is something that is fed by thanksgiving. And contentment means I am so okay, I'm contented, and I'm focusing on the positive and I'm ignoring the negative. It's important to understand this. You overlook what is lacking and draws a sharp focus on what is in hand. Whatever you are lacking, please overlook. But whatever is available, keep focus on that. Many Christians today are fighting it hard to be contented because they are giving a sharp focus on what they are lacking. And they are overlooking what is at heart. I want to tell you that is the difference between your success to the world we are living today. You will find that there is this, the contentment of your heart tells you, even with this bottle of water that is at heart, I thank God. Yes, I don't have money now to buy the bottle of soda, but I have this bottle of water. I keep a focus on what I have and I overlook what I don't have. Brothers and sisters, whether we like it or not, we must train ourselves to do that. I know we are living in a competitive world, that if I am walking on this black shoe and I'm seeing him with the brown, I desire before the end of next week, I should have a brown shoe. We are living in a competitive world. People have become even jealous in the name of admiring. People have become covetous in the name of admiring the fashion. When I'm not going to continue, even I'm driving this small car and I meet my sister driving the big one, and it's like I want to compare. I also need to be driving the big one. We are living in a competitive world, but Christians, let us remember, We are called upon to focus on what is at heart and overlook what we are lacking. That does not mean we are not praying. We are praying because we need God to supply. But I'm not going to be sick because of what I don't have. I want to be healthy because of what I have. I will not allow sickness because of that struggling and striving. And you know, God knows what you need. You remember Jesus telling them, okay, I think we will touch one more scripture. I'm about to close so that we take the Holy Communion. Let's look at 1 Timothy. No. Oh, I can't leave this. I can't leave. The same chapter 4 of Philippians. Oh, time is making me to run. But I'm contented. I have peace. Amen. Verse 11. Give us verse 11. It's important. Verse 11. Not that I speak in regard to need. Look at that. Not that I speak in regard to need. For I have learned in whatever state I am to be content. For I have learned in whatever state I am to be content. This is Apostle Paul. And those who don't know, Apostle Paul was one of the richest apostles. You may think he was poor. He had a lot of resources, even with his tent making and the donations that were coming from the church in Thessalonica. The people of Macedonia, Corinthians were doing the same. He had a lot. But he says, I have learned in whatever state I am to be content. And I want you to know this. When you see Apostle Paul saying that, that word, content, to be comfortable, to be cool, to be peaceful, was to make him continue more and more. The moment you become content and peaceful because you are thankful in your heart, the next thing you find is that you have long life. Verse 12. Look at what he says in verse 12. I know. Somebody say, I know. I know how to be abased. In other words, I know how to be low. And I know how to abound. Everywhere and in everything, I have learned both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. Look at the knowledge he has. That when I meet you, my brother, even when you have no hope of your lunch and it's morning, or you don't have hope for your supper, you still know how to be content. I don't know whether this is possible, but it is, because God giving us the Holy Spirit is expecting us, even at the time of suffering, you are content. And I want to tell you why. Because you have learned to thank God. You have learned to walk with God. You can afford to say yes. Even though things are like this, I am okay with God. Hallelujah. Let's go faster now. 1 Timothy chapter 6. 1 Timothy chapter number 6. 1 Timothy chapter number 6. Verse 6. Now, godliness with contentment is great gain. So you cannot be contented if you are not godly. If you are not walking in the ways of God, you can't. So when you combine godliness and contentment, that's a great gain. I'm not a loser. By being contented, hallelujah. When I am walking, when I'm sitting down, when I'm lying down, when I'm waking up, to be contented, it is not a loss. It is a gain. Many people, can I say this? Some people that are in hospitals, they are admitted there. If all their sicknesses were analyzed, it is easy to find that some of them is because of worry. And I say the another time, they are worried, they are not contented, they are not peaceful, they are fighting within. It's like they are eating themselves. because of lack of peace, lack of contentment. But I want to say today, in the name of Jesus, under this anointing, may you be contented in your godliness, and that will remain a great gain. Can I teach you this? The moment it is so hard, ask yourself only one question before you start getting so upset and worried. And you see, yeah, things are not very good. When it is so dark and it's so tough for you, ask yourself only one question. After all, what is at stake? What is the worst that can happen? The moment a human being asks himself or herself that question, it becomes the end of worry, the end of fear. The moment you analyze yourself and ask, okay, it is like that, so what is the worst that can happen? Until you find somebody say, even if it is death, nobody would die twice. You say YOLO, eh? Let me tell you this. It's important, my dear ones, to fight, strive, to fight worry. You need to see this. A great gain. It's a great gain to be in godliness and contentment. Do you have a seven? Give us seven. You also see it. It is there with us. For we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out. Here in Avuja Kabisa. It is certain. Apostle Paul tells Timothy, it is certain. We brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out. Listen, from birth to death, look at a human being. You came naked, nothing. Even the fashions you talk about today, did you know? You knew nothing. When your mother was taking care of you, whether she decided you remain naked or clothed, it was upon her decision. You knew nothing. But today you are so worried. Okay, don't worry. We have to be dressed. Imagine the food that you are worried about when you came on earth. You didn't know the menu, how the menu will be. Somebody was in charge. The other thing you find, the person is born between birth and death. We are fighting so hard. We are working so hard. And I don't want to recommend laziness. We are in agony of mind. We are struggling. We are striving. We are remaining sleepless, looking for things that we did not fight when we are entering, and looking for things we'll never hold as we exit. So the mystery of this life is that the devil would like to put you on your toes so that you keep running with no peace. And every time it's like your joy, instead of rejoicing today with the little you have, you are postponing that joy, waiting for tomorrow to receive that which you do not have. And then you are left that way. Tomorrow comes, you get it, and then you postpone again. And until the end, I say no, I refuse, and I declare my life shall be contented. It doesn't matter. Apostle Paul told them one time as he wrote Romans that nothing can separate us from the love of Christ. And he says, no matter what, is it mountains of worries? Is it people? Is it what? Is it hunger? Is it naked? Is it fight? Nothing will separate us with this love. We need to hold on to that. As I wind up, look at Hebrews chapter number 13. Hebrews chapter 13. Let's look at that. Hebrews 13. Let your conduct be without covetousness. Be content with such things as you have. Now we have to repeat that. Be content with such things as you have. Not what you don't have, what you have. For he himself, he said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. I will never leave you nor forsake you. Look at the writer of Hebrews. Let your conduct, look at your neighbor from far or near. Just tell them, I'm watching your conduct. Yes, I'm watching your conduct from now. Let's watch one another. Conduct yourself without covetousness. Covetousness. It's a command. Thou shalt not covet your neighbor's what? Your neighbor's what? We can learn from one another. We can learn and copy. But if my heart is so covetous, I'm fighting within because I feel like I am the one who should have it and not you, then that is evil. And he says, be content with such things as you have. For he himself has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. I remember when God gave me my first vehicle, KAG 324V. I remember that four-wheel vehicle after struggling so much. Later, after some months, somebody came driving a Nissan pickup, the small one, like the 1200. It was brand new. And then she told me, Pastor, I have to tell you the truth. You heard I was in Dubai. You know, I've been admiring this car of yours. And I'm sorry I never asked you maybe how easy it was to get one like that. But I want to tell you, I went purposely looking for that car and I missed it. That's how I came in this one. I didn't ask her many questions because she was elderly. But I kept asking myself, what is the problem? So I started remembering some issues whereby even in a meeting there could be a talk. Like, you know, you can tell. Let me tell you. When somebody is not contented with whatever God has given them, they will be having the spirit of jealousy. And it will land them in trouble. You spend more and buy the worst. You better be contented. And if at all you want to learn with somebody, I admire this shirt, Jeff. I think I need to know where you made it. I better come to you. Not because I want to surprise you so that you start saying, I also have one like you. No, we don't want to live like that. Please let us avoid. Let us open our hearts and let us have the peace of God.